Hello, everybody. Welcome to Starto. My name is Eli Regalado. Joining us today is Peter Vogel, CEO and founder of Plink. Peter, how are you doing today?
Pretty good. Thanks for inviting us on.
Absolutely. So, Peter, what exactly is Plink and what do you folks do?
So we started Plink about a year ago.
Okay.
And we initially described ourselves as the first ever Facebook credits loyalty program.
Okay.
And what we did is we drove consumers from Facebook social games to go eat and shop offline, and then we gave them rewards. So we were essentially an online to offline loyalty program, and some of our earliest big clients were people like Burger King, Taco Bell, Outback Steakhouse, and our members would earn Facebook credits that they use in the games every time they ate at those partners.
So I'd go to, so I'm a big gamer, I go to Taco Bell, I go to Burger King, I eat a ton of food, and I am rewarded by credits that I can then use in online games, is that correct?
Exactly. So if you play Farmville, for example, one of Zynga's biggest games, you'd go spend...
Small game.
Just a small game.
Little guy.
Only been copied a few times.
Yeah.
If you spend $5 at Taco Bell, you get 5 Facebook credits. We track it via the consumer's credit card, and we automatically send them Facebook credits.
Okay.
They can use them in their game immediately. So if you're playing Farmville, you can buy 3 more cows, or you can plant a new crop of exotic purple corn.
Okay.
So it's something that for people that love games, you know, the people that do play games are very passionate. They're very into it. They're playing games online for more than an hour a day, every single day.
Wow. So, and you guys are doing something a little different than now, yeah?
Yeah, exactly. That's a valid way to put it. So we essentially pivoted from Facebook credits.
So is this a good thing or are you scared shitless?
It turned out to be a great thing.
Okay.
I'll say in the beginning we were probably a little uncertain. So we started out with Facebook credits, but even a few months ago our members were asking us for other rewards. You know, they may love Farmville, but you know, every time they go to Taco Bell, maybe they want to get a different reward. Maybe they want to get, you know, a gift card from Amazon or iTunes, etc. So a couple months ago we started getting that feedback. And a month after that, we found out from Facebook that they were essentially shifting away from Facebook credits.
Huh.
So the timing was actually good. So we started working with a company called Tango Card that actually enabled us kind of all in one swoop to have relationships with Target, Amazon, Nike, Best Buy, Starbucks, Home Depot, Gap, huge, almost all the biggest brands online. So now, as of August 1st, all our consumers have been able to earn Plink points, which are then redeemable for all of those rewards I just described to you. So we're still giving away Facebook currency, which is now more Facebook gift cards than it is credits, but you can choose anything you want. So we're appealing now to a much wider base of consumers, not just the social gamers. So that's really the good news.
So Tango Card, I'm assuming they already have these existing relationships, they're the ones that set it all up, and then you basically had a joint venture where you kind of just merge those two offerings, and now this is the new, improved, and way cooler Plink.
Yeah, the new and improved expanded reward catalog that that we believe is appealing now to all internet users, not just gamers. And the way it works is through Tango Card, we have direct access to give away, you know, Amazon gift cards or iTunes gift cards or Target gift cards. Or consumers can also opt for a Tango Card, and a Tango Card then can be used at, I think, up to 30 different brands.
Right.
So a consumer can pick their card specifically, or they can just opt for a Tango Card and pick it a later date.
All right, so Peter, I got a question. How do you make money with Plink?
So our business model at Plink is 100% performance-based. So our restaurants and retailers only pay us after we drive business into their stores. So for example, we'll use the Outback Steakhouse. This is hypothetical, but say they pay us about 10% commission.
Okay.
So a consumer goes in, spends $50, Plink gets $5. We give about half of that back to our consumers in the form of rewards. So the consumer gets a couple bucks in rewards. And the real power of the program is the coalition of the partners. It's not just what you get at one place, but when you go out to eat a couple times a week, when you shop at our retail stores a couple times a week, it all adds up. So every dollar or two you earn here or there, all of a sudden you're getting a $20 gift card before you realize it.
Right, and you're able to use them at those different partner restaurants or partner organizations. So you went from just being on Facebook and just doing that, right? So you kind of had like really defined market.
Yep.
And now you're like in the wild world.
Yes, that's a good way to put it.
And my initial thought is like, how in the hell is this guy paying for this to market this? But,
right.
But I think you have an answer for us.
I do have an answer, and I'm very happy to announce that we did just close our Series A round. So we raised $3 million.
Bam.
Yep.
So for all you startups who say you can't raise money in Colorado, $3
million. $3 million, and it was from GrowTech Ventures, which is a Virginia-based VC firm that's actually one of the oldest and one of the bigger ones. They've been around since 1984. Which is back to almost when kind of that VC world was starting.
Right.
They've invested over $1 billion. They were one of the earliest investors in Living Social. So they have a lot of experience. They're very savvy in kind of the social commerce space. And they've invested in over 100 companies. So
wow.
The amount of contacts and industry know-how and kind of expertise they bring is huge. So it's not even just the money.
I mean, right.
They've already started helping us. Kind of with guidance and introductions and yeah, all the people they know for sure.
That's cool. So how did you reach out to these guys, right? So it's one of the biggest things that I hear is like, it's so hard to be a company in Colorado. We don't have enough
right.
money. We're not on a coast. These guys are in Virginia. You're in Colorado. So
right.
how the hell does this happen?
So we reached out to people, West Coast, East Coast, Colorado.
Let me say people. So you reached out to VC firms.
We reached out to VC firms.
Okay.
We actually had, we hired a PR company and we've gotten decent PR over the last 6 months or so.
Cool.
And so we've actually had some VC firms reach out to us.
Sweet.
We've more aggressively, we've reached out to a lot more than have reached out to us, obviously. So we have set up a lot of different calls. We've met with a bunch of them. We also competed in a bunch of contests. Plink was picked as one of the Business Insider's top 10 startups of 2012.
Oh, cool.
So we went and did a 5-minute pitch in front of an audience in New York. We got picked by Vader TV as one of the top 8 startups. So we went and pitched for 3 minutes in LA.
Yeah.
So we've actively been entering these startup contests, which I would definitely recommend. There's lots of VCs, there's lots of contacts, and you get a lot of press.
Right.
So for us, I mean, it took a long time. You know, I won't say it was easy.
Right.
It took for a while. I was probably spending more than half my time meeting with investors, doing investor presentations. Trying to contact investors, going to visit investors,
building a business on top of it.
Yeah, and it's almost funny to say it's easier to build a business, I think, than it is to raise the money to build the business. So
yeah,
so that's, I don't know if that's good news for startups or not, but it took a lot longer than we expected. I think that's a lot of people say that
always.
It takes longer than you think, and it's a lot harder than you think.
Yep,
for
and
sure.
And you're married, right?
I am married.
So. One of the big things that we always discuss down here, and we've talked about it a couple other times with some other founders, is this whole work-life balance,
right?
Right? So you're a startup CEO, huge pivot,
right?
You're raising money, you're talking to all these investors, you're going coast to coast. Where does your family come into all this?
Obviously family is always the most important thing, but it's also great to have a supportive family. I don't have kids yet, so
okay.
That makes it easier,
I think.
But my wife's been very supportive, and I think maybe she's now even more excited since we actually did raise the money.
Yeah.
I don't know how happy she would have been if it didn't work out. But since it did work out and we got money and we're a little more stable and
yeah.
you know, have jobs for a while, it's all good.
Right.
But you know, there is a little sacrifice, and I did travel a little more than I usually do and
sure.
was definitely gone for a while and work a little later hours, and it's a little bit of a sacrifice for
so
sure.
what one piece of advice can you give to the founders that are watching this who are they're not funded, they're in the same position you were up until recently, and you know, they're telling their wives it's gonna be okay, we're not gonna lose the house, you know, I'm gonna be at the t-ball game, you know, and they're sweating bullets, you know, so what piece of advice can you give? Maybe sometimes that the dust arose and you kind of had to be Superman to the rescue. You know, what worked for you?
You know, I think, and I didn't do this at first, but the more openly communicated, the more I actually told my wife about what I was doing, the more she kind of understood the stress and effort that I was putting into it. And the more I told her about meetings I was excited about or how close we were to certain things or why I was going somewhere. And kind of the more information I got, she felt, I think, a little more like she was almost part of it and
right.
understood and almost empathized a little more, like the struggle. There's actually a great article, James Altucher, I think it's how you pronounce his name, but there's an article called I think it's called The Struggle on TechCrunch, and it's all about how hard it is to raise money and to run a startup. And that actually has some great advice too. And about all the hard situations you face. But
yeah.
But I guess that's the one piece of advice that I found helped. And it doesn't mean it's perfect, but
right.
The more you communicate, I think, and kind of involve your significant others or even family about what's really going on, and not just like, I'm really stressed out,
right.
But like why?
Why are you stressed out?
Yeah,
what's
why
leading
you're stressed
up to
out?
It?
Who you're meeting with and what they said and if they're really excited, et cetera. You know, right. I think that helps.
Yeah, and she's probably cool though too.
She is cool though too.
That helps.
She's probably, yeah. hopefully she's gonna watch this.
Yeah. Yeah, we 20 when we're out of here. So let's talk about Facebook real quick then. Obviously,
sure.
You know, you were kind of just right in the mix, so you're still involved quite a bit. What's new? What's going on? What can we expect? What are you seeing?
Well, you know, it's interesting. So Facebook shifted away from Facebook credit, so they're phasing that out. And
yeah, and why did they do that, by the way?
Well,
we're Facebook, we don't have to give a reason, or?
So all Facebook did is post something on their developer blog that basically said, we're shifting away from Facebook credits because we want to make it easier for developers to accept currency. Like okay. They thought the credits may be difficult for people to understand. So they're trying to enable payments in 60 countries. So you can imagine, like you use dollars here, pounds in England, right. Yen. So it was difficult for them to get everyone to understand what credits is and then translate that into another currency.
Right.
So it had this confusing barrier. That's what they said.
And what was the first thought that went through your head when you saw that?
Kind of surprise, shock, I guess, because we really thought when we started this, we started thinking about ways to make Plink, you know, probably a year and a half ago. We started building it about a year ago. And Facebook credits, we were pretty convinced, was going to be the kind of the new up-and-coming universal currency on Facebook.
Yeah.
You know, people would use it to get Netflix subscriptions.
Yeah.
You would buy things from your friends. You would, you know, you could even leave it, if someone makes a post or a picture, you can leave them 2 Facebook credits, right?
Yeah.
And then you can use Facebook credits to play games, buy digital media, et cetera.
So you saw this as almost like virtual world that where this currency was just going to ebb and flow,
yeah.
And you guys were going to be at the middle of it.
And Facebook's so big, right? You'd think they have the power to, if they want to do that, Facebook could do it, right? If anyone could, right? And so they started off in games, but they put very little effort behind it, and they never educated consumers. And I'm sure if you don't play games, you probably never even got Facebook credits.
I never heard about it until I met you.
Okay. So you only use them in games really right now, and there's no way to really find out if you have Facebook credits. There is, you would never know this, but if you click on your profile on Facebook, click on payments, then click on credits, it'll show you your balance.
So go to my profile, click on...
I think it's, you hit your profile,
okay.
And you bring up a profile page, and you hit, I think it's payments, and then there'll be a thing that says you click on Facebook credits, and it'll show you. But you have to click 3 times deep in order to find out if you even have Facebook credits.
Right, mine's probably negative, like my bank account.
Probably. So, Facebook never educated people as to how they could use it.
Okay.
So for example, there were some situations where you could actually watch, you could watch Widespread Panic live on Facebook. You know, there was a show in Austin about a year ago.
Yeah.
You could pay 70 credits, or the equivalent of $7,
cool.
And watch Widespread Panic live. It was the only place you could see it unless you were attending the concert.
Right.
Right? They didn't really promote that. There were a bunch of movies, you may have seen this, but like Dark Knight, the Batman movie, you know, was actually shown on Facebook a year ago.
Oh, wow.
You could pay like the equivalent of, I think, 30, 40 credits, or $3 or $4, and watch it online.
Wow.
So it was thought that was the precursor of a lot of things to come, but it never really happened. Facebook never promoted it. They kind of started moving away from it in games and never really put any muscle behind it. And then they're now phasing it out. And so what they're switching to now is more of kind of like an iTunes type currency. So on iTunes, you know, you add a credit card to your account.
Right.
And then whenever you buy something, it just dings it. Right. Or if someone gives you a $10 iTunes card, you type in the code and then you have $10 in stored value.
Right.
Right. So that's basically what Facebook's, they're going to have a Facebook account.
Okay.
And so they think Facebook has about 10 to 15 million people's credit cards on file so far. That's the kind of estimate.
Wow.
15 million people used credits in 2011. And it's estimated that a lot of those bots.
So how big of a market value is that then? So, I mean, how big of a market? Are we talking hundreds of millions, billions?
Yeah. So they generated in 2011, 15% of Facebook's revenue was from credits, basically.
Wow.
And what was... we thought showed a lot of promise there is, so 15% of Facebook's users, or no, so 15% of their revenue came from credits,
okay.
But only 3% of their users were using credits.
So 15% came through credits.
Only 3% of their base.
Wow.
So you can imagine if they could double that.
If they just put some marketing out.
Yeah.
Totally.
The other thing Facebook never did is Facebook also keeps a 30% cut of anything that anyone that accepts Facebook credits. Hmm. So it's, Apple does that too with iTunes.
Yeah.
But so what that means is that, you know, social games could do it because they're basically just giving away virtual goods, right?
Right.
Zero marginal cost.
Right.
But someone like Netflix or Spotify, I mean, they're paying royalties.
Where there is actual hard costs associated with it, right?
And a lot of those businesses, you know, news, TV, movie, music, there's not a 30% margin that they can give away. So Facebook stuck to that. And so Facebook hinted right before they canceled credits, or right before their IPO, Facebook said they would consider lowering that 30% in certain industries outside of games. So people think that means in digital media, things like music and movies.
Right.
And I've predicted for about the last year and a half that you will soon see, you know, you'll be able to subscribe to a Facebook version of Netflix, you know, and pay with credits.
Yeah.
Or you'll pay for Pandora or Spotify on Facebook and have a special type of account that interacts with your Facebook account, and you pay for, now that they've gotten rid of credits, you still have a Facebook account. Now it's just Facebook dollars, right?
Right.
So it's you can still, nothing has really changed. It's really a change in name only.
Right.
Right. So you'll still have an account. You can still buy stuff. People can still sell you things. Developers can still make money. It's just all done in dollars now.
I gotcha.
So there's no real change. So we're going to continue to give our gamers, as one of the options for the rewards, Facebook currency.
Right.
But obviously we've added all the others we mentioned to expand the scope to be appealing to everyone internet-wide.
Got it. So $3 million, pivot. You got a cool wife who's supporting you. You got this whole wave of good stuff moving your way. What are you guys doing now? What's next?
Let me just say first, my wife will be very excited. She's never been mentioned so much in any interview I've done. So what's next? So we're continuing to grow. Right now we're at about 6 employees. We hope by the end of the year, so when we find the right people, we'd like to be up to around 12.
Wow.
You know, with the money, we're beefing up our mainly sales, biz dev, and engineers, site development, et cetera.
Okay. So for the people that are watching this now that are looking to join a really cool startup and actually get paid?
Yes.
So what type of engineers?
We do pay our employees. That's a good point.
Yeah. So what type of engineers are you looking for?
I have to tell you, I'm not the right guy to ask about that.
Okay.
We have a CTO.
Go to the Plink website.
Yeah. Go to the Plink website. And we'll have all the positions listed there.
Cool.
My email is just peter@plink.com.
Okay.
I'm hiring the sales guys. So
cool.
If there's any aggressive sales guys out there who would love, this is a very national opportunity, you know, reach out to me.
Yeah, let me ask you. So sales obviously is the lifeblood for a startup, right?
Yep.
You gotta, you know, kill and then eat and then kill again immediately, right?
Right.
So what are you looking for in a good sales guy? And how do you hire good salespeople?
I mean, obviously, we're looking for someone that has some sales experience, and it doesn't necessarily have to be at the national level. We're looking for people who are very aggressive, who aren't afraid of rejection, who aren't afraid of cold calling. I mean, you have to be very outgoing. You have to be willing to contact people on LinkedIn, email, randomly call them, walk up to them at trade shows, and interrupt their conversation and ask for a card.
Yeah. Sounds like my dating life.
How's that going?
But I've been divorced 3 times, so that'll do.
So what else we're looking for? I mean, obviously, relatively articulate and writing skills these days, I think, are more important than ever.
Sure.
You know, we do a lot on email. LinkedIn is one of our biggest sources. Both myself, the first sales, I was doing sales and biz dev for, you know, the first year. We've hired someone to help, and we're going to hire a few more.
Cool.
But, you know, I probably 75% of all my contacts came from LinkedIn.
Wow.
And it's just being very aggressive, reaching out to people. And we go to trade shows. We sponsor trade shows. We aggressively go walk the floor, go up, meet every person we can.
So no fear, highly aggressive, and just someone that just gets after it.
Yeah, motivated by money is always good.
Yeah.
You know, obviously, you know, we pay a base, but commissions, I think, are a big driver for salespeople as well.
You'd think that's why someone would want to be in sales. You know?
Mostly, yeah. I mean, yeah, if you weren't motivated by making the big bucks, you could do something a little more stable, I think. You know, sales is more up and down, you know?
Absolutely.
You have big excitement, you know, you lose the account once in a while.
Yeah.
But, you know, I think it's worth it. I mean, I love sales. I've been in sales and kind of biz dev for a decade.
It's kind of like being bipolar, you know? It's like,
I don't know if my wife likes that, but
it's exciting, though.
It's exciting, yeah. Definitely.
So, closing remarks. You know, what news or advice do you have that we haven't addressed, and you know, what can you tell our audience?
You know, for I think startups that are, you know, aggressively trying to raise money, not to be afraid to reach out to the biggest, most famous VCs on LinkedIn or on their websites. I found it surprising how many VCs, you look on their websites, list personal email addresses, easy ways to get in touch with them. Wow. And I got responses from a lot of them. Most of them said, we're not interested, but they responded. They read our little pitch and said yay or nay. Some of them we met with, you know? So not to be afraid to walk up to, you know, the most connected, influential people you know and ask for help. You know, we found if you don't ask for something, you're 100% of the time you're not going to get it.
Right.
You know, if you ask for it, you know, maybe 90% of the time you won't get it, but that 10% that either someone says yes or someone refers you to someone else. And, you know, I think that's where a lot of the big contacts come in is someone always says, you know, like, I know so-and-so would love this. Like, I'll have to give it to him. And
right. They
put you in touch with that person. And that person might say, like, well, I'm not the right guy in my firm, but so-and-so just looked at a deal like this last week. Let me forward you on to him. And, you know,
so this little community and be able to get in there and kind of start navigating through.
And you have to go to a lot of events. And we even went here locally. I mean, we didn't raise money locally, but we went to the Rocky Venture Club meetings.
Yeah.
We pitched at their 5-minute pitches. I pitched personally down in Colorado Springs twice.
Wow.
At the, I can't think of the name of the Colorado Springs organization, but.
That one. Okay. I'm pretty sure there's
but
only
I pitched,
one.
No, there's actually two or three.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, there's more than you would think in Denver, Colorado Springs, and Boulder. If you look them up, there's a couple organizations in each city.
So why do we have more funded deals coming out of these guys then? I mean, if we have three organizations in Colorado Springs.
At least two. I don't know if this is real. At least two in Colorado Springs.
Let's just say we have one.
Yeah. Yeah.
Why aren't we hearing about more Plink $3 million Series A's?
I don't know. I mean, it may just be a question of numbers. So even though we may have two down there and two here and a couple in Boulder, in Silicon Valley, you might have 50. And the East Coast, in New York and in, you know, Connecticut and a bunch of those places that have some of the most VC, you might have 100 firms, right? So I think even though we're here, 90% of the companies we spoke with and met with were from other places. Hmm. But that's not to say that we didn't try here. I mean, we talked to lots of people here as well.
Right.
It just, you know, a lot of times it's just the company you click with, you know, you never know who it's going to be. Yeah.
Yeah. Cool. All right, folks, well, that's all the time that we have. Peter, thanks again for a great interview.
Thanks for having me.
And we look forward to hearing about what's going on with you and Plink in the future.
All right, thank you very much.
Thank you.